Hello everyone. Today we will be discussing the three most important recent bill which has jolted a shock to National Democratic Alliance when Harsimrat Kaur, the cabinet minister for food processing industry, resigned from her cabinet, and simultaneously President Ramnath Kovind accepted her resignation on the recommendation of Prime Minister of India. Is the things have gone so worse? What are the basic reasons and what all things you can write in your answer? We'll be discussing these things, and simultaneously I will be coming with an issue every Saturday regarding one important issue in that week, so that you can write a good answer or essay on that topic. So basically it is about three important bills which are being passed as an ordinance in last few days in the time period of corona by NDA government. And recently these bills have been passed. Out of these three bills, two bills have been passed in Lok Sabha. What are the provisions of the bills? What is opposition to bill? And what all concerns raised by stakeholders? Will go into it. So let's go for these things. First, the three important bills. Out of the three important bills, first bill is the Farmers Empowerment and Protection Agreement of Price Assurance and Farm Services. This is the first bill where farmers are protesting and they are expressing their concern. I will go into what are the provisions where contradictions are there and what are various concerns raised by farmers and their organizations and various political parties. Let's go into it. Let's think about first bill. Now, first bill, what it says, basically first bill has various provisions. Out of the provisions, these are the three important provisions. First provision is to provide for a national framework on farming agreement. So basically this bill talks about providing a national framework for agreement between farmer and big corporate houses, farmer and wholesalers, farmer and national and international companies. A national framework wherein there can be a contract farming between farmer and this particular major international corporate houses. So what it says, it provides for a national framework on farming agreement that protect and empowers farmers to engage with agribusiness firms, then processors, wholesalers, exporters or large retailers for farm services. Now it talks about farm services. It talks about sale of future farming produce at mutually agreed remunerative prices, and this framework will work in a fair and transparent manner. Basically it talks about an agreement between farmer and big corporate houses. Now what are the concerns raised? First thing, whenever there is an agreement between a very large party and a very small person, this small person do not have any bargaining power. That small person, that small institution or that small individual do not have any bargaining power in the consultation. So whenever this agreement will be there between small farmer and that big corporate house, always that big corporate house will have an upper hand, will have an upper edge, and he will mold or manipulate the terms and conditions of that agreement in his own favor. Over a time period when the farmer will not get remuneration, he might lose his land, he might lose his livelihood, and he might walk out of that land, and that entire land will go in the clutches of big corporate house. This was the first important. Why? Because it says this particular agreement will be between two unequal parties. It could lead to agri-colonialism, and all these big corporate houses will again have catch hold of entire agricultural business. And most importantly, as there is no limitation on land selling or the land purchased by an institution, it could lead to a new zamindari system through these big corporate houses. Second, it says that this particular bill will give access to modern technology to all the farmer. But most importantly, this modern technology is a costly technology. These big corporate houses will not provide this modern technology to small and marginal farmer. And most importantly, they will give this entire modern technology only to the farmer where it is profitable, where it is remunerative, where they can export the goods and services at all other places. They won't give access to this modern technology. So this will be a kind of mirage only for a few big corporate houses and few large farmers who have complete hold over the agriculture. Then third, it talks about marginal and small farmer with less than 5 hectares of land will get benefit through contract. Absolutely no. always remember the big sponsor, big corporate houses, they do not discuss with small farmer. They always discuss with large farmer, or they will discuss with an agent who can provide them a group of farmer who can give them that large chunk, that large piece of land. So again, there will be a middleman will arise, and this middleman will act as an agent. He will try to manipulate that land. He will try to get hold of that entire land. And in case of India, more than 60% of land is a small and marginal land. And it is very difficult for these corporate houses to have contract with this small and marginal farmer. So ultimately, big corporate houses will have contact with the agent, and the entire purpose to get benefit for small and marginal farmers will be destroyed through this particular agreement. Sponsors unlikely to prefer dealing with many small and marginal farmer. They won't discuss with small and marginal farmer. So basically, these are the three important provisions. Now let's go into the second act and what are the various issues regarding the second act. Second act, it talks about, or the name of the second act is the Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Promotion and Facilitation Bill. This is second bill which has these all these issues. What are the issues? See, what second bill says, it talks about to provide for the creation of an ecosystem where farmers and traders enjoy the freedom to sell and purchase product outside mandis. It means recently we have Model APMC Act, and Model APMC Act says that farmers must sell their produce, whether it is vegetable or it is cereals and pulses or whether it is fruits, within these mandis, within the premise of mandis. So this particular bill, it gives freedom to farmers and buyers to sell their produce interstate, intrastate, anywhere, no need to go to mandis. Now see, yes, this is very good thing that a farmer should have a freedom to sell their product anywhere. But tell me, if we don't have organized agricultural produce market committees, then where will these farmers go? We can't look after just a very small section of people who are not interested to go to vegetable market to purchase vegetable. 90%, or I would say majority of people, go to vegetable market to purchase these vegetable or to purchase these cereals and pulses to the those mandis. Now if we reduce these mandis, if we reduce the value of these mandis, ultimately over a time period, initially farmers will definitely get the benefit. But farmer is a very busy person. Basically, he has to carry out all farm activities, he have to carry out all selling activities, he have to look after his families. Then if the mandis are no more relevant, then the farmer will be clueless. Over a time period, what will happen when these mandis or APMCs become outdated, then ultimately farmer will become a kind of ultimately connected to big corporate houses, and big corporate houses then will start charging transportation cost, storage cost, and all new kinds of commission agent will come between the farmers and big corporate houses. So ultimately the big corporate houses will start exploiting farmer. So basically it is a good step to remove the mandis, remove the middleman, remove the agent from between farmer and consumer. But here you are removing APMC, middleman, agent between farmer and big corporate houses. Here remember, the big corporate house itself is a very big commission agent having very strong economic prowess. What is, state government will not able to get mandi fee. Mandi fee is a very small amount. It won't make any difference. But the most important loss to the farmers will be, once these mandis and the APMCs will lose their relevance, then farmers will have no option but to go to big corporate houses. And big corporate houses are profit making. They won't care for farmers. Rather, APMCs are being run by political parties. Though commission agents are there, political parties, politics is there, but at least majority of farmers get a very good platform to sell their produce. One thing that can be done, you can have a provision to sell food at these APMCs, at these mandis, and also freedom should be given to sell the produce wherever a farmer wishes. Second provision, to encourage interstate and intrastate trade. Yes, it is a very good thing to provide platform in various states where there is deficit of various goods and services. But the most importantly, basically it is a particular concern raised by all farmers, organizations and political parties. They feel that since government has allowed this interstate and intrastate trade, it could be a ploy in the mind of government to dismantle minimum support price over a period of time, so that this minimum support price is no more relevant. So this is basic thing which is being opposed by farmer. All farmer organizations feels this bill is against minimum support price procurement system, and they feel this MSP will be dismantled over a period of time to favor only big corporate houses, so that the big corporate houses can manipulate farmer to get their produce at the throwaway prices. Third one, reducing marketing transportation cost to the farmer. But most importantly, it is very difficult to predict whether government will implement all the decision. Execution is the most critical part of any governance where most of the government fails. So whatever structure we have right now must be discussed with everyone. Then third bill which has raised concern is about the Essential Commodities Amendment Bill. Now what this it says? This particular amendment, it proposes to remove commodities like cereals, pulses, oilseed, edible oils, onion and potatoes from the list of essential commodities. Now if these things are no more essential commodities, it means there is no limitation on the stocking or storage of these goods and all these things of agricultural produce. Now it means ultimately what will happen, government will not have any control over the storage, the stock, the company or the person who is stocking, making stock of all these things. It would ultimately affect the supply of all these things, and when it is affected, its prices will be manipulated by big corporate houses having large capital unused with them, having large capital which can be used by them for their own benefit. So here big players to have an edge and are likely to dictate the prices of all these essential commodities, which will make people with lower income more vulnerable to fluctuations in the prices of these essential commodities. Then to attract foreign direct investment, but the most important latest decision on ban of export of onion has created confusion in the minds of farmer that whether government is interested in selling or exporting these goods at the outside market or not. So this attracting foreign direct investment also won't come to small and marginal farmer. It will again benefit only the people having large land, large capital and big corporate houses. Now these are three important bills. They are contentious provisions and the concerns raised by various farmers organizations, political parties and all other institutions. Now here I will just summarize who are the institutions involved in protest, who will be getting benefit, what will be the benefit, what are the oppositions to the bill, so that these things can be written in your answers directly by you. So let's go into it. First thing, which are the organizations which are opposing? Various political parties like Aam Aadmi Party, Indian National Congress, then recently Shiromani Akali Dal, Trinamool Congress, all these are the political parties which are opposing these three bills firstly. Second, various farmers organizations like Bharatiya Kisan Union, then All India Kisan Sangharsh Coordination Committee and some sections of the farmers, especially in Uttar Pradesh, then Telangana, then Punjab, Haryana, Northern Rajasthan are some of the regions where protests are going on very widely. They have blocked national highways to repeal this bill. Still it was being continued. Even Shiromani Akali Dal said that they are rethinking over alliance with National Democratic Alliance. Still government was undeterred, government continued. It was very clear from the decision of President of India to accept resignation of Harsimrat Kaur regarding these three bills. So it is very clear that government is moving, government is going to continue with these three bills. Now what are the issues, what are the benefits as per the government that are being received by the people? So first benefit, farmers can take their benefits anywhere. There is no restriction on where farmers are going to sell their produce. So first benefit will be borne by farmer. Farmers will have access to sell their produce wherever, whenever they wish. This will reduce the need to go into APMC or in mandis to sell their produce. Second one be is this particular bill allows interstate or intrastate sale is allowed beyond APMC. It means farmer can search for all kinds of market where they can get good price, where they can have remuneration to their agricultural produce. Third, state can't levy any fees or cess or taxes on the sale of this goods by the farmer. Then next benefit is farmers and buyers can reach at an agreement before procuring harvest. This will help farmers to protect any kind of risk involved in sale of these goods, agricultural goods. The next one is doing away with stock holding limits on key commodities. This will help in a person to hold or to stock any agricultural goods so that farmers can sell these things without any limitation on stockist, and stockist can give price to farmer. The next one is it talks about provision for contract farming. Then the most important, center can regulate or it can impose stock limits on supply of certain food items under extraordinary circumstances when there is steep rise in prices of certain goods like onions, potatoes and certain cereals and pulses. It means this provision has been kept in the law where center can take extraordinary measures whenever there is chances of rise in prices of agricultural goods. The next benefits is most important. It will liberate farmers from the clutches of middlemen, that is Arhatiyas. Next one, better prices and remuneration will be received by the farmers. More and more private investment will come in the agriculture. This will help in development of agriculture for a longer term. It will attract more foreign direct investment. This more foreign direct investment will bring more technology, more investment, more innovation, and agriculture will become more and more competitive. Most importantly, having more research and development in Indian agriculture will bring more innovation and technological investment in agriculture, which will increase remuneration of farmer. Simultaneously, it will increase productivity of Indian agriculture, which is at this time showing a very dismal show as compared to China and all other Asian nations. But simultaneously, there is opposition and there is a ground for opposition. Why there is opposition to these three bills is a serious question which must be studied by everyone. First, it will help very few farmers having large holding or who are having, see, whenever you thought about a businessman, when he demands a land, he says whether your land has a water or not. Then he talks about the quality of your soil. Then he talks about the accessibility of your soil. It means this particular law will not help the farmers having fragmented land holding, having their land in a very inaccessible region, having a land which is not connected by road, and most importantly, a land which is lack of water, like drought and drought prone region, will be at the receiving end will have the losses. Second, it will help only big corporate companies, and once big corporate companies have complete control over farmer, they will destroy livelihood of farmer. Once bill is passed, it would dismantle minimum support price is the biggest fear is being expressed by almost all the farmer organization. Then farmers and farming organizations were not consulted. They are saying that this bill is not all inclusive. We were not discussed. We were not taken into confidence. So this is also one of the contentious issue where a bill which is affecting millions of farmers in India, how they are not taken into consideration. If government feels that this bill is going to benefit farmers, then farmers know what is their benefit, what their benefit is not. So farmer must be taken into consideration, all farming organizations, so or leave farming organization, at least all political parties must have been taken into confidence to discuss the provisions of the bill. So this is farmers and farming organizations were not consulted. Huge losses of revenues will be incurred by agricultural produce market committees and mandis on the loss of sale outside the APMC. Farmers could lose their right to their own land over a time period when they don't have bargaining power. Fragmented land holding is the most important issue before implementation of this law, as the people having fragmented land will not have any bargaining power against the negotiating power of big corporate houses, and they won't have terms on their own benefit. This law, which is being implemented without taking views or consultation of states, is anti-federal, or it violates federalism, which is the basic structure of Indian Constitution. And most importantly, when we are saying that lakhs of that farmer will be released from the clutches of commission agent, but here we forget that commission agents are citizens of India. Already corona, vagaries of monsoon, this excessive rainfall has affected their livelihood, and if we remove this middleman, if we destroy the structure of agricultural produce market committees and mandis, it will lead to loss of livelihood of lakhs of commission agents, especially in Punjab and Haryana, Telangana and all other agriculturally strong state where commission agent, and specifically it won't affect the commission agent who are having very high stake, or richer commission agent will not be at loss, as ultimately all these commission agent will again be acting as a middleman between farmer and big corporate houses. But the most important loss will be borne by small commission agent who are having or who are getting just a very small amount of commission from these all APMC. So what can be done here? Basically, government can bring transparency about the commission agent, the amount of commission they are taking, the way they are taking, whether they are exploiting farmers or not. But removing this entire commission agent from this entire structure will be a loss to citizen of India only. And state government will lose mandi tax, which is also one of the important taxes. Already, state governments are incurring major losses due to GST. They are not able to cope up with the entire losses of coronavirus and all other thing. If we bring these taxes, state government will start losing their more and more taxes. It will again strain the financial relations between center and state. So these points can be basically used in your answer directly. Every Saturday we'll be meeting with one point which can be used in your answer. So thank you very much. Have a good day. Thank you.